Hello everybody, I am Zach Peterson. Welcome back to my channel. In this video, I'm going to be answering all of your great questions on my videos on the Altium Academy channel. And the topic for today's video is PCB footprints. Now, of course, PCB designers out there have to use PCB footprints because that's the only way to get package data into a PCB layout. And occasionally we get some great questions about footprints. Now, recently I did a couple of podcast episodes, one with Kristen Aguiar from Altium and another with Elizabeth Bustamante. And those podcast episodes were all about PCB footprints. And since doing those podcast episodes, we started to get a lot of great questions. So of course I thought it was very necessary to do this video. Let's go ahead and jump in to your questions about PCB footprints. This first question comes from our How to Reverse Engineer a PCB from Gerber Files video on Altium Academy. And the question is, back in 2009, Altium had capability to auto recognize footprints after such import from Camtastic to CAD. Why that feature has been removed, I have no idea, probably due to somebody else's IP ownership. Okay, so in this video on reverse engineering a PCB from Gerber Files, one of the steps is to convert the CAM data into CAD data. And one of the outputs from that conversion is, of course, a bunch of pads, which then make up a PCB footprint. Now, apparently, I didn't know this, but apparently the Camtastic viewer in Altium Designer at one point had the capability to recognize footprints in CAM data. Now, at the time of making the video and at the time of getting the question, I wasn't aware of any software that could auto recognize footprints from CAM data. However, I did a little bit of digging and I did find one piece of software that is able to do this, and it is CircuitCAM. So this is one CAM tool that is specific to PCB design and PCB manufacturing. And you can see here that they do have the capability to recognize footprints. And you can even see right here this line on one of their support pages. After package recognition, an associated optimized footprint can automatically be inserted to replace the original footprint. Sounds pretty convenient. Now, I've never used CircuitCAM before, but hey, if the CircuitCAM folks are out there watching this video, maybe you can hook it up with a license and we'll pimp out your software on this channel.
PCB design software.
Hi, I'm Tanita.
This next question comes from one of the 1 minute design review videos, and you can see here on screen we have a footprint that we're examining in the video, and in this particular footprint we have vias directly in the pad. The question is, what do we do with the vias in that scenario? I didn't get the solution. Well, the big problem with this particular footprint is that the paste mask is open over the entire set of vias in that central pad on that integrated circuit. So if you just go back and pause and take a look at that design review, or if you check out the link in the description and go and watch that design review, you'll be able to see that there are some vias directly in that pad on that integrated circuit. Now, normally you need the vias on die-attached pads on integrated circuit because they're there for thermal handling. The challenge is that if you open up the paste mask across those vias aren't filled, then solder can wick onto the backside of the board. And that isn't always a problem. Sometimes there's nothing on the backside of the board, so a little solder wicking never hurt anybody. Sometimes you have components on the backside of the board, and so if solder wicks through some of those vias, maybe it creates some shorts between components. The best solution here is to just close that paste mask just a little bit. By closing that paste mask a little bit, you'll confine the paste application directly to the pad in regions where there are no vias. By doing that, you can minimize or even prevent solder paste wicking through those vias to the backside of the board. An even better solution is to just fill and cap those vias, although again, it's not going to be necessary to do that in every single design. Filling and capping also requires planarization. Planarization, fill and cap also add cost to the board, so that's one of the factors you'll have to weigh when you're preparing a board for production. This next question comes from the same 1 minute design review video, and in this question you can see here, they are referencing some capacitors, and these capacitor footprints have a very cool capacitor symbol detail right in between the pads. The question, or rather a comment, is from Scott Pelletier, and you can see here he says, "Looks cool, but no silk under components for me." Frankly, I would agree. There really shouldn't be any silk screen under small SMD passives like the capacitors that we see in that 1 minute design review. The issue is that silk screen underneath those capacitors could provide just a little bit of lift on the capacitor package. And depending on how much paste is deposited on the pads, you might get a little bit of lift, and that results in an insufficient solder connection or insufficient solder fillet on the edges of those capacitor leads. Now, if you had a thick stencil and you had a lot of paste being deposited on those pads, I think this is going to kind of be a moot point, but then you're going to have other issues with having too much paste, such as potentially solder flowing off of those pads and then creating bridging across the pads for a small case SMD passive. Now, this is a problem that you might find in a lot of different footprints from third-party sources, including in the manufacturer part search panel in Altium Designer. All of those footprints are designed to different standards, and you'll have some designers that really like putting silk in between pads or underneath packages in their PCB footprints. I think it really is a best practice to not do this, particularly on small case SMD passives. It does look pretty cool though. Now, there were some other comments about putting silkscreen in the footprints for small case SMD passives, one of them coming from Electrohawk Copper Compass. Electrohawk writes, "Our assembly house would cough up fur balls if we had capacitor silkscreen like that. They prefer no silkscreen at all unless it's absolutely needed. Silkscreen can be problematic in many cases." My reply to this comment is, I actually agree that's true if there is some uneven silkscreen. In the case if it's symmetric, it's probably not so bad. So if you have symmetric silkscreen in that footprint, I could actually imagine a case where you have equal lifting across both pads, and that would reduce the risk of tombstoning due to lifting across the two pads on that passive. Also, if you had larger capacitors or if you had an integrated circuit, I don't think this would be such a problem. But if anybody out there in the PCB assembly world has a comment on this, hop in and let me know in the comments. This next question also comes from one of the 1 minute design review videos. And this question is from Alicia Hobby 6274. "What does the direct connect mean? Can you please explain?" Now, this particular question is in reference to thermal connections on vias and SMD pads, as you can see here on screen. Now, the thermal connection on vias and SMD pads is one of the default PCB design rule settings in Altium Designer, and it is actually one of the most common things that I see in the 1 minute design review submissions on the Altium Academy channel. Now, the issue with thermal reliefs on SMD pads really depends on what those pads are connected to. For example, if you have an SMD component and those pads are connected to a very large copper polygon on the same layer, or if you have a lot of vias connecting your copper to a plane on the inner layer, it's going to pull a lot of heat off of that component during soldering, and you do create a risk of tombstoning, particularly on very small SMD passives. However, on vias, thermal reliefs are pretty much never needed, in my opinion. You're better off just applying the thermal relief when you need it to an SMD pad rather than applying it to a via. Now, the question was about the direct connect setting, and direct connect is something that you set in the PCB design rules, or you can set it on the pad in the properties panel in that PCB footprint. So either way is going to eliminate thermal relief when you don't need it. You can also create a global design rule for vias that ensures you have a direct connection to all copper, whether it's a plane or a polygon, in your PCB layout. This question also comes from the same 1 minute design review video, and this question is from Envision Electronics. Envision writes, "Altium content vault is full of bad parts, even super common ones. Missing layers, wrong footprints, wrong inconsistent symbols. Is there any QC?" Those footprints and models that you see in the manufacturer part search panel are provided by the manufacturers of those components. Altium doesn't have a sweatshop where they're paying people 50 cents an hour to make PCB footprints and schematic symbols. Those are provided by the manufacturers of those parts. With that being said, you just kind of have to hope that the manufacturer creates the footprints correctly, but they do give you a really great place to start enforcing your own standardization on PCB footprints. Also, I'm just gonna be honest with you. I absolutely hate creating PCB footprints. It is my least favorite thing to do. I kind of expect all the footprints to just be there, and at least the manufacturer part search panel gives me a place to go to get some footprints, and then I can modify them to my own standards. So in that sense, it is a real time saver. Now, this is part of a bigger issue within the PCB industry, which has to do with footprint standardization. According to one of our recent podcast guests, Elizabeth Bustamante, she advocates that there should be some standardization on PCB footprints. And Kristen Aguiar, the other podcast guest who's talked about this issue, says we're probably never going to have standardization of PCB footprints. So I'm going to have to get both of these dynamite women together to talk about this issue because I think it's really important and I think it would be a great conversation. So stay tuned for that video. This next question comes from the 1 Minute Design Review for John Hatfield. Here we have a question from James McCall 7135, and James asks, can you explain why you'd break that pad into four smaller openings? Now you can see here on screen which pad the question is referencing. Here you have a central die-attached pad on an integrated circuit, and then you can see here in the paste mask layer, we have the paste mask fully open on that pad. A better option is to just use four individual openings for that paste mask. One of the reasons you would want to do that is to prevent that pad from shifting or rotating during reflow soldering. Another reason to do that is because it leaves room around the edges for those vias that you need for that die-attached pad so you can heat sink into an internal plane. Another option is to just apply a negative paste mask expansion only to that pad. By applying a negative paste mask expansion, you limit the amount of solder paste that gets put onto the pad. There will be some copper margin around the area where that solder paste is deposited, and then it's going to help prevent or limit the amount of skew that might happen during reflow soldering. And this final question in this Q&A video is on the video for the recent podcast episode with Elizabeth Bustamante. You can see here we have a question from Nanocosm. This question asks, as close as possible to the pad when talking about silkscreen is a good example of the footprint problem too. That comes down to the fab you use, correct? Now, I can't tell you the number of footprints I have seen from third-party providers where the silkscreen gets a little too close to the copper pads. You can see here one example that comes close to being a bad design, but it's not that far off. Here on screen, on the left side, we have an example of an integrated circuit where some silkscreen is placed underneath the component. And you can see here it's getting close to the edges of the pad. It's actually getting close to the edges of the solder mask opening, but I've seen many other footprints where the silkscreen comes right up next to the copper pad and even falls over the solder mask opening. This could be a problem because there's always some limit on the level of precision of silkscreen application during PCB fabrication. You'll need to maintain some minimum clearance between the edge of the solder mask opening or the edge of the copper pad and that silkscreen. Now, some PCB fabrication houses will clean this up for you. For example, if you have silkscreen falling on copper pads, they will segment out that silkscreen so that they remove it from the copper pads in your fabrication data. But not all PCB fabricators are going to do this. Some will just run the silkscreen exactly as they see it, and they're not going to tell you about it. The result is that you could have information that was important in your footprint that no longer appears on your board because essentially it got printed directly onto a piece of copper and then eventually got cleaned off or it can rub off. If some of that silkscreen remains on exposed pads during soldering, it could interfere with formation of solder joints, and of course that's really bad for reliability in PCB assembly. Now this is one of the most common problems that I see on the 1 Minute Design Review submissions on the Altium Academy channel, but there is a design rule that will check for this automatically. You can set a clearance value between the applied silkscreen and the solder mask opening or the exposed copper in the PCB Rules and Constraints Editor in Altium Designer. There are similar design rules in other PCB design applications that you can use to perform the same type of automated rules check. Thanks for watching this video, everybody. Make sure to check out the video description for links to some of the content that I've discussed in this video. Also, coming up soon, I'm going to be doing another Q&A video on PCB footprints because all of you fine folks have been leaving so many great questions about PCB footprints on the Altium Academy channel. So go subscribe to Altium Academy, make sure to subscribe to this channel, and we'll see you next time.